Hey there! Welcome to a brand new episode of Music Express. My name is Twan, and in today's vlog you will see my interview with Dutch singer Nance, in which we talk about her career and, of course, the brand new 24/7 single Do You Want Me. But before we start with the interview, please make sure to subscribe to my channel, and very important, also make sure to click the bell button, because then you will get a notification the next time a new vlog is online. Alright, here it is, my interview with Nance. Enjoy! Nance was born on September 10, 1973, as Nancy Anna Francina Kolen in Asten, a small town in the south of the Netherlands. Besides her TV work, Nance is mainly known as the singer of 24/7, which is one of the most popular Eurodance acts in the world. 24/7 was founded in 1989 by DJ and producer Ruud van Rijen. When Ruud was looking for a singer, he discovered Nance in the Vrieburgt in Asten, which was also the club where Ruud was the resident DJ. The first 24/7 track Nance did the vocals for was I Can Stand It. And she was only 15 years old back then. I Can Stand It became a big hit, and that was the start of the success story of 24/7. So far, 24/7 has sold more than 20 million records worldwide. Besides I Can Stand It, Nance did the vocals on tracks such as Are You Dreaming, Slave to the Music, Is It Love, Take Me Away, Keep on Trying, and many others. But the 24/7 story ended for Nance around 1995, when she was forced to leave the group. But good news for the fans, because Nance is back with 24/7 together with Hanks and Jax. And they just released a brand new track called Do You Want Me. So a good reason to sit down with Nance to ask her about her career, the new 24/7 single, and more. My first question to Nance was how old she was when she started to listen to music.
Very young, because I have an older brother. He's 6, sometimes 7 years older, and he was a DJ also. So I think from him, he influenced me to listen to music. So I was really, really young.
Okay.
Yeah, and so like 4 or 5 already. Okay. Yeah.
And do you remember some of the bands or the acts that you were listening to then?
Because he was older, he was listening to a lot of soul music also, and some names are flipping in my head, but I cannot recall many names at this moment.
Yeah. So at the age of 15, you were discovered by a producer Ruud van Rijen in a club in Asten called Vrieburgt. Can you tell a bit more about that?
I was actually a little bit too young to go to the club, but I was allowed to, because it's a small village, everybody knows each other, so they were like, okay, let's let her in. And Ruud knew that I was singing, because some people told him, like, oh, she's singing in the bathroom, you can ask her maybe. Because he already made a single called I Can Stand It with MC Fixit, and the single had a robot voice. And he wanted to do a remix of that with a female voice. So he was like, okay, let's ask her and see what's happening. So I went to his place and I recorded the single.
So how did that go? Were you like nervous for the vocal session?
To be really honest, I wasn't really nervous, but it was funny because I was standing there in his house. It wasn't a big house, but he had an extra room where he had a microphone, and right next to me were the ski shoes and his holiday pictures, and there was an iron board. So it was really funny to stand in his house between the laundry and stuff, and to record a song that went a major hit 6 months later.
Yeah, that was about to say, like, you did the vocals of the very first ever 24/7 track, I Can Stand It, back in 1989. That version became a big success together with Captain Hollywood and Hanks and Jax.
Yeah.
How and where did you guys got to meet each other?
Well, MC Fixit, I don't know really what happened at that point, but somehow he didn't do that song. So the record company in Germany who picked up the song I Can Stand It was BCM Records at that point. And there was like a record manager called Charlie Prick, who later became our manager. Mm-hmm. And he knew Captain Hollywood, Hanks and Jax, because they already danced with some famous German stars. And Captain Hollywood was, to say it nicely, I mean it nicely, he was really eager, you know, he wanted to perform and be a rapper and a singer, and Hanks and Jax were great dancers. So I think that Charlie said, okay, we have to ask that guy to join the group with the two dancers. And that's how we became 24/7 Future and Captain Hollywood, Hanks, Jax, and Nancy. And the first time we met was in Germany when we did our very first photo shoot. for the group 24/7.
Yeah.
It's really funny because I never met those guys, mm-hmm. and we had this photo shoot, and we were a group, and I was like, okay, hi, I'm Nance. Okay, let's pose. It's really strange.
Yeah, and you were still like 15 or 16 back then?
15, 16, yeah, 15 going on 16. Yeah.
So Icon Standard reached the golden status in countries such as Germany, Spain and Italy, and besides that it became a top 10 hit in the UK, Switzerland, the Netherlands, Austria and Sweden. So were you surprised by the success?
Yeah, yeah, of course. Because when I was a little girl, I was a little bit like a dreamer. I wanted to be Madonna and be a singer and a star and be on stage. So for me, it was a big surprise that this was happening and it all started so fast. So we had to do a video shoot and we have to go to all these countries and perform and be stars. And that was really strange for a girl of 16 years old.
But I think you already had some dancing experience from a group here in Austin.
Yes, because when I was a young girl, I started at the Dinky Dancers, which was a really famous ballet school around this area. So I had some dancing moves. Mm-hmm.
You were still going to school, of course, and all of a sudden you were in the charts all over Europe. How was that time for you?
Everything was so fast. It was living in a fast lane. So afterwards, when you're older, you start to realize, okay, so that's what happened to me. But at that point, at that moment, I was really living my dream. So I didn't even realize what was happening. I just did what I had to do, and I enjoyed it a lot. But it was really like this.
Yeah. And I think later you quit school.
I had to quit school, but at that time I wasn't allowed, but I did it. Mm-hmm. My parents agreed because they saw that I wanted to do this so badly. Mm-hmm. So they did that for me, but I wasn't allowed.
Yeah. So do you still remember the very first time you had to perform with 24/7?
No, no, I cannot recall my very first performance, I'm sorry.
Is it true that in certain countries you couldn't really walk outside on the streets without being followed by fans?
Yeah, but so many countries. I mean, after a while, especially later on when the group changed and we had Slave to the Music, our music was a hit worldwide, so we expanded our fan base, and then it was in some countries it was really hard to go out. So sometimes we weren't even allowed to go out. The record company or people from the record company say, okay, please stay inside, don't go, because it's too dangerous.
But I think I heard a story that you guys sneak out of the hotel at night to go out sometimes.
Yeah, I also remember that one time I was in, this was with Captain Hollywood, Hanks and Jacks, and I sneaked out to a club in Spain. And Charlie, our manager, he was looking from the balcony into my hotel room, and he was like, the lights are on, but she's not there. That's strange. So then he called my parents in Holland, like, she's gone. Where is she? So my parents had to call me later, and they were really mad at me. Oh, you sneaked out of the hotel room. What are you doing in the middle of the night alone in Spain? But I had a little boyfriend.
So after I Can Stand It and Are You Dreaming and the album Street Moves, Captain Hollywood left the project. So Ruud van Rijen found another rapper, which was Stacey.
Yeah.
Do you still recall meeting him for the first time?
The only thing that I remember was that we, with Captain Hollywood, we did a tour with Swatch MTV. It was sponsored by Swatch and MTV. And Stacey was also there as a pre-act. So I think I met him there already a few times. But I cannot recall the first time that we did something together. Yeah. I have some holes in my brain when it comes to that part.
Yeah, probably at some event then, I guess.
Yeah, but we knew each other already from that tour.
Okay. So the sound of 24/7 changed a bit, and 24/7 became one of the first, or maybe the first, Eurodance act with a male rapper and a female singer. Mm-hmm. You guys had many hits such as Slave to the Music, Is It Love, Take Me Away, and many others. Do you have any idea how many gold and platinum records you did collect during those years?
I think around 18 in total, maybe a little bit more by now, because over the years you keep selling records even when you don't know it. So in the beginning, I know that we had like 18 million sold records, now it's over 20 million. Mm-hmm. But I think I have like 18 golden, platinum, double platinum albums at home. Yeah.
So is there one you're the most proud of?
Well, I'm really proud that in the beginning I got one from Italy, Germany, Austria and Switzerland, and those were the really old vinyl golden albums framed. So I have four and those are the best. I have a piano in my home and three of them are up the piano and they're the best. The other ones are more like, you know, you put a CD with glue on it and that's it. So the vinyl ones are the best ones.
Yeah. Do you actually have a favorite 24/7 track yourself?
I knew this question was coming, so I was listening to some old albums yesterday, because there are so many songs on that I didn't even know. And one of the albums is called I Wanna Show You, and there's also a song called I Wanna Show You. Mm-hmm. So I listened to it and was like, ah, actually that's a really nice song.
That's a bit more laid back.
I wanna show you how I feel, and it's really nice.
Yeah. So it's maybe time for a remake.
You never know, yeah. My voice changed a little, so yeah, it should be.
You did perform all around the world as well, so not only on radio and TV, but of course also in many clubs and at festivals. Do you have a favorite performance or a special memory from the time you guys were touring?
So many things happened.
You can write a book, I guess.
Oh, yeah. But as I said, there's also so many things that you keep forgetting. And then after a while, somebody talks about it and you go like, oh yeah, right, I remember. But I remember one show we did in Spain, and I was young at that time. I smoked at that time, so I smoked all day and I drank only Coke and Coca-Cola, and I didn't even eat that much. And my voice at that time was on tape. So the rap parts were always live, but my voice was there as a backup. So we had this show in Spain with Captain Hollywood, Hanks and Jax, and I didn't feel so good. And we were already dancing and stuff, so I thought like, oh, maybe I should sit down. So I was sitting down on stage, and Hanks and Jax were all like, she never does that. Why is she sitting on stage? So, and then all of a sudden I passed out. I just fell, like I was dead meat somehow, but my voice kept going on tape. It's really stupid. So, but then my manager, Charlie Prick, ran on stage, our manager, and he tripped over a monitor and he fell on top of me. So that was really horrible. A memorable moment on stage. So he took me backstage and we stopped the show, and then they put me in my hotel room and they got shrimps, big shrimps. Mm-hmm. And I had to eat a whole plate of shrimps too. Be healthy again. So that's what I can't forget. And I think that we also did a really, really nice show, but that was with Stacey in Prague. It was so nice. We had this whole big stadium for us. It was our show. Mm-hmm. And with all the fans, like 10,000, 20,000 fans, just to see you 24/7. Yeah. And our parents, Ruth's parents, my parents, and I believe Stacey's family came with the bus to look at us.
Oh,
that was
by bus.
By bus, to check. Yeah, so that was really nice. Yeah.
I think you guys still have like a big following in the Czech Republic.
Yeah, I think we do. Yeah.
So around 1995, there were a lot of struggles in the band and you had to leave 24/7. That must have been a very difficult time for you.
Very difficult time. Especially because I had to leave. A lot of people think that I left, but I had to leave due to a lot of misunderstandings, struggles, fights, to be really honest. So that really was a sad period for me. And still, I think till last year or 2 years ago, it was still hard for me to talk about. I didn't even want to talk about it. But of course, in interviews, you get a lot of questions about it. And I'm an honest person, so I give a reply. But I still think it's a pity that it went the way it went. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We should have stayed together longer and to have more success.
Yeah, it would have been better to take a break with the whole band for like a year maybe.
That was also suggested. Yeah. Why don't you take a break? You should go on a vacation, because if you are together 24/7, shit happens, to be really honest. Yeah. So it would have been better if we had a break. You know, just kept working. But okay, you know, looking back now, how things went, it's okay.
Yeah. Everything happens for a reason.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, yeah, not long after that, you started a solo career and you also did focus more on TV work here in the Netherlands. Did you miss the touring, or was it maybe a blessing for you to be home more often?
It was a blessing for a while, because I loved my TV work. It was very successful. In the meantime, I got myself a new husband and I had a baby boy, a son, and he's 12 now. And I really felt good being at home, being a mom, and be there for him. But I did some performing already with the Divas of Dance, which are Desiree from Two Brothers and Linda from Teaspoon. And every time when I saw them going on tour with the Two Brothers, I was a little bit, oh, I want to be there too. I want to be on this big festival and feel the fans and the applause. So I was a little bit jealous. So I missed it. Yes, I missed the touring a lot. Yeah.
So then in July 2019, a picture of yourself with Captain Hollywood and Hanks and Jax did appear on social media. Yeah. I think it's safe to say that a lot of people got very excited when they found out you guys did a show together. How was it to see everyone again after all those years?
Well, we didn't do a complete show, I have to be really honest. And I think that a lot of people missed that like 20 years ago, we already had a little reunion. We met in Düsseldorf.
Oh.
Just to have lunch together, the four of us, and we had a great time. And then after that, we didn't see each other for like 15 years. And then I saw that Captain Hollywood had a festival in Nuremberg, and that was the base of Captain Hollywood and Hanks and Jacks. So I said, okay guys, if I come to Nuremberg, will you all be there? And then we'll have fun. And Hollywood was performing that night, and I said, maybe we can go on stage and do just one song together, just for fun, you know, for the fans. So Hollywood was really like, oh yeah, let's do this, and Hanks and Jacks also. So we went there, but we hardly saw each other. I saw Hanks and Jacks a long time, but Hollywood was really busy, so I didn't speak to him a lot. Actually, I saw him on stage, and we did like half a minute of I Can Stand It, but that little piece of film went over the social media channels, so that's what you saw.
Yeah.
But for me and Hanks and Jacks, it was like coming home. And we were like, yeah, if we want to do this, we want to be back on stage. And right at that time, a little bit after that, Ruud van Rijn came to me and said, do you want to be performing under the name 24/7 again? Do you want to do that?
So that was good timing.
So one on one was two, and I said, let's make a three with Hanks and Jacks.
Yeah, so now you guys are back together?
Yeah.
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 And a brand new single just came out, which is called Do You Want Me?
Yeah.
How's the feedback on the single so far?
Very good, very positive vibe. That's really nice, because it's always a little bit like scary. Are people gonna like this song? And but they're liking it, and it's a really catchy song. Yeah. It stays in your head, so it's really nice. But it's unfortunately we cannot perform, but it's good if the radio plays it now. So when we go on stage, everybody can sing along.
Yeah, that's like my next question, because we're still in the middle of a pandemic.
Yep.
So yeah, I bet you cannot wait to get on the stage to perform the song. And all the classics.
Well, last year was really a bummer because me and Hanks and Jacks, we were in the Netherlands for a whole week, and we started rehearsing. We've been eating together, dancing together, laughing together, and we had our first performance would be in April, I think the 8th or the 3rd, I don't know exactly. And then the pandemic started, so we never set one foot on stage, which really frustrated me. So now we are training and calling and FaceTiming and like, oh, next year, maybe next year. So we hope this summer, but I have a hard heart in. I don't know. It's really difficult.
Yeah. Fingers crossed.
Definitely.
Yeah, maybe it's still a bit early since Do You Want Me just came out, but are our plans already for a follow-up single?
No, that's not really follow-up plans, but I know that Ruud and I, we said, okay, we want to make music. We feel so good now, and we are really having this music vibe. So Ruud was like, okay, let's make some more songs. And okay, I'm fine with that. Let's do this. I don't know how fast we're going to be or what we're going to do, but we're going to do it. Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
So Stacey and Leanne recently announced that they left the 24/7. What does this mean for the future of the group?
That's a good question. That's a good question. I don't know what it means. It means now that there is more clarity, that there is still one 24/7 left, and that's me with Hanks and Jacks. Yeah, but the fact that they left came as a surprise for all of us. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Okay, so we have to wait and see.
Wait and see.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a pity, but yeah.
Is there still something you really want to achieve with 24/7?
Well, for me personally, the only thing I really want is to have fun and maybe to turn the past around into better times.
Yeah.
And that's what I told Ruud also. We discussed about the past a lot and about all that happened, and we said some mean stuff about each other. But we are now like, okay, we're still young, we can do this now. Let's make fun and let's end this positive.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we want.
Yeah.
That's for us the main thing.
Yeah. So besides your work with 24/7, what else can we expect from you later this year?
I don't know. I'm working on a new TV program, which will be on air like this weekend. I don't know when you're gonna, but people can see it now. And I hope that with 24/7 we can start performing finally and make more music. That's it. I don't know.
Yeah. So
I live by the day. Yeah. I just live by the day.
Yeah. Oh, that's good. And the last question: pineapple on pizza? Yes or no?
Pineapple on a pizza?
Yeah.
Hell no.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for your time and good luck with everything.
You're welcome. Thank you.
All right, that was it. This week's vlog, my interview with Nance. Nance, thank you very much for your time. Much appreciated. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed the vlog. If you did, make sure to give this video a like, leave a comment in the comment section below, and make sure to subscribe. Also make sure to click the bell button, because then you will get a notification the next time a new vlog is online. And in case you missed it, in 2018 I made a visit to the studio of 24/7 producer Ruud van Rijen for a detailed interview, so make sure to check that one out as well. Once again, thanks for watching, and until next time, bye bye!